nice introduction, so much better than the one I had at West recently. The person meant well, but it was at a luncheon, and the lady said to the group in general, would you like to enjoy yourselves a little longer, or are you ready for the guest speaker? So I have this terror now that I'm hoping that you can both enjoy yourself and listen to the guest speaker all at the same time. My bio always scares me because I'm like one of those people. My mother would have said, like, why don't you just pick something and do it, you know, do it thoroughly. Because I tend to do a little of this and a little of that, and I can't seem to settle down with any one thing. But I think to most of you probably, I'm known as a political wife, which is true. I plead guilty. I've been married to Bob for 33 years. We just had our 33rd anniversary. And we have three wonderful daughters. Judith, who's a lawyer specializing in Aboriginal law. Lisa, who does public policy. Shocking, the daughter of a politician who chose to do public policy. And Eleanor, who's still in school studying urban geography, which is a fancy way of saying cities. And she's just working on her doctorate now. As a political wife, it used to be that the advice people gave you was show up, shut up, wear beige. We've come a long way, and on this International Women's Day, I think everyone luckily can laugh at such advice, though I'm reminded too of the, when Yasmin was being so nice, of the stories about Marion Pearson, the wife of the late Prime Minister. Two great stories of Marion's, one of them which you've probably heard before, but you may not have known that it was her who said it first, which is that she said behind, I'd like to say beside, but behind every successful man stands an amazed woman. And and the other great story about Marion, in those days when they used to campaign, it was mostly by car and by train, and they'd travel all over city to city, town by town, doing these whistle-stop campaign tours. And one day at the end of such, having gone to many, many stops and visits and hosted in people's homes and so on, they were kind of doing a debrief at the end of the day, and someone said, you know, Mrs. Pearson, is there anything that you'd like to bring up? And she said, yes, 5 donuts and 7 cups of tea. So it's part of the political wife. We've come a long way there, of course. It's no longer an absolute horror should a woman have a different political opinion about an issue than her husband, or a husband have a different view than his wife. The political spouse is no longer, in fact, all that relevant, thanks to years of politics in which many more women have been elected. Not enough. There's a lot more to do to elect women and to elect women of diverse representation. When I was watching that wonderful video and learning a little bit more about the IDI, I was thinking, wouldn't it be great if you could just figure out a way to get yourselves all like elected, and the parliament would look like the IDI, or the IDI could replace parliament as a sort of true representation of what this country is, what we look like, who we are, just the diversity, the sense of respect, the inter-dialogue of people from all different faiths and backgrounds and national origins. You know, don't take a back seat. You're way far ahead of a parliament that, and you'll forgive me, I know in the spirit of this room it's all nonpartisan, but if a little bit of politics sneaks in, it's just in my blood now. So just forgive me, I'm not proselytizing, I'm just sort of telling you where I come from. But it's a very partisan place now. People have always been partisan, but it seems to be worse. It seems to be harder to go out for a drink or have a coffee with someone from another party. It just seems to be almost all the time amendments are not listened to, changes, even improvements that people acknowledge in committees are improvements to legislation get voted down because you know, they just will not, in this particular mood of our government, accept participation and improvements and suggestions by people from other parties. And I think that's a sad thing. So they really do have a lot to learn from organizations like this one. I also ask your forgiveness or your forbearance in that I've written some notes, but I hate reading speeches. I think it comes from my marriage, my time of listening and watching Bob. I just like to be able to look at you and to see people when I talk. So if it's a bit disjointed and I bounce around a little bit, I'm sorry. There's just a few things I want to talk about, and I don't necessarily have those wonderful connections that you have when you have it written down. The first thing I want to say is that in 2011, President Obama declared March to be Women's History Month, like we have Black History Month in February. And I kind of say, why don't we all do that? Like, why? I mean, in most areas of progressive policy, Canada has led the way over Americans in gay rights, in a lot of areas that we've been leading the way, or at least were for a long time, on environmental issues, on many women's issues too, on the Divorce Act and so on, and changes in equal pay were brought in Canada long before those legislations and those ideas sort of were part of the government and still aren't in some parts of the United States and some states. But I think here's one where the Americans have a leg up on us, because I'd like to imagine a whole month, where women's history is talked about, where we talk about our contributions in the arts and our contributions in music and in politics and in finance and in health and in pushing for childcare and in promoting progressive and compassionate ideas and legislation, where we talk about breaking the glass ceiling, where we talk about women in poverty, where we talk about Aboriginal women, which is perhaps, at least it is, I think, the largest challenge and the greatest shame that we have as Canadians today, is the still and continuing long disparity between life on reserves and the quality of life and chances for success among our Aboriginal families. I hear a lot about this because of our daughter Judith, who's involved in this all the time. So I just sort of like to imagine a month that we would do that. And I also would like to imagine more civics and more history being taught in our schools, because I have somewhere on these sheets a quote, but it doesn't even matter if I have it, from a man named Hobsbawm, who basically said, people today just don't know history. We just don't bother to take the time to know our history. And if we don't know our history, if we don't celebrate what we've accomplished in the past, chances are we'll have to fight for it again. We'll lose the sense of why we had these great battles, why we did these things, and then another generation might have to take on those challenges once again. As women, and I welcome, of course, men in the audience too, but as women, I think we all know that life is about a balance. It's about the balance of your work and your family life. And it's also about having a kind of positive influence and bringing up the values and the ethics of the children in your family. Your spouse does this as part of the joint role if you're in a marriage of bringing up children. But more often than not, even in 2013, it is still the woman who has the largest, if you will, chunk of the family side of that balance. Single senior women, 14%. So for the average to be down to 9%, we are carrying a great deal of that burden of poverty. And I think changes can be made. We have made changes in the last century through legislation, but there are still many things that are holding women back from being equal and from bringing those rates to something that's much more amenable to improvement. Canada still ranks quite high. We're only 20th of 31 countries, so we're not a third world country. We don't have the rates of suffering of people who are in refugees. We're not at war. We have a great example to tell the world about getting along as a country without fighting each other. We fight in words rather than with weapons. The history of Quebec in Canada is a great example. The diversity of our communities and how people have been able within the Canadian democracy to both celebrate their own culture as well as be part of the mixed culture, if you will, of the national culture. There's no definition of a Canadian. We are all colors and all kinds, and it's wonderful when we can show that to the rest of the world, who are kind of surprised when people of various colors, backgrounds, diversities represent us as ambassadors or in our embassies or as our governor general, like Michael Jean or Adrian Clarkson. This is part of the great lesson that Canada can show the world. But we do have our own challenges, and one of them is poverty. Another one is the I'm sure you heard about it in the news this week, the tremendous disproportion of Aboriginal people who are in our jails. There's the continuing challenge of the missing and murdered Aboriginal women. There are cases and challenges. And if none of you have ever been to a reserve, I can only tell you that it's like going into the past. There's unpaved roads, lack of sewer and water, outdoor toilets often, garbage on the streets because of a lack of very, very little for people to do. And what danger that is two things. One is it leads many young people to despair. They don't know where or what they're going to be doing. Many come to the cities but don't have the skills to cope with the big world of the city, so we need jobs and training and adaptation programs, but we also need jobs right on the reserves so people can, if we continue with reserves, so that people can have work in their own community and maintain their way of life and their culture as well. So we have to listen to the communities and try to help as best we can for them to actualize their lives. I guess one of the things I wanted to say too, in terms of history, is that I kind of, by not being political, I'll say that there are sort of two groups in terms of legislation that can be of benefit to women. I'll call one the sort of progressive and the other the regressive group. And we can be a help to each other or our own worst enemy. And the best example I can give, if you'll forgive me, Yasmin, was in your riding, where there were about 30,000 people who voted for the Liberals and the NDP, but a Conservative won that riding with just less 800 votes more than Yasmin. So it's sort of an example of how the majority of people in an area wanted someone progressive, but because there were two candidates, it allowed someone in a that didn't represent those particular views. Now, it could have been the opposite as well. It just happened that her riding, Don Valley East, is a great example of how the forces of progressive politics, if you will, somehow were sort of their own worst enemy, because it allowed the representation in that riding anyways to be someone that didn't represent the views of most of the people or what they were trying to do. So politics is important. How people vote, how you choose, whether you pick a political point of view that is ideological, whether it's science-based, whether it furthers the ideas that you believe in, makes a real difference. And sometimes people have to make choices and have to make the kind of choices that would help further the issues that they have. Now, here's where the politics creeps in a little bit. I think as women and as members of the two more progressive, or you might say three more progressive parties on one side of the spectrum, there has been over the 20th century, and this is just fact, I guess, that there have been over and over again pieces of legislation that have come up, whether it was the Canada pension, whether it was old age security, national health care, whether it was multiculturalism, whether it was justice, whether it was labor law, whether it was an independent foreign policy. These were the issues that were fought for by people on the progressive side, and time after time argued against by people on the, what I call, the regressive side. Now, I think you have to make a decision. You have to say, okay, if this is what represents me, and on either side of that spectrum, then fight for it. Join the team. Be part of what that group is trying to do. But if you feel that you want those kind of legislation, and those were fought by the then progressive Conservative Party of the day, you can only imagine, oh, I am getting political, how much more opposition there would be to such policies if they were brought in today. So the answer is to try to not be so partisan all the time, not be ideological, but to find policies that further the causes that you believe in, that as men, as women, as citizens, you feel are in the best interest of the values and the communities that you're a part of. And to I guess what I'm saying is to get involved in the political process and to fight for those ideas as active citizens. You seem to be doing that in your own group and in fostering the nonpartisan discussion, which is so, so useful in civic society. I wish, too, that civics was taught in schools, too, that people would understand, and in a truly nonpartisan way, understand how government works, what the different levels are, how to stay part of it. And I sort of imagine that, you know, they talk about getting more young people involved in politics. One of the ways to do that would be if we possibly, see, I have no stake in this, I can suggest these things, if we could extend the vote to people a little bit younger. If you can learn to drive and get a license at 16, imagine if their vote in their high schools wasn't just, you know, a sort of straw vote and you see how the school voted, if they indeed do that, but an actual participation, and so that when they learned about government and learned about policies and how policies evolve in school, they actually had a real vote that counted. And I think that might breed, just like learning to brush your teeth at an early age, a habit that they would continue for years and years and would be part of civic engagement. But that's just one idea. There isn't, I see, here's the written part of my speech. There's not a girl in Ontario today who, as of a few weeks ago, doesn't think she couldn't be premier just because she's a girl. So we've made some progress right there. And there's there's not a girl in Alberta who thinks that. There's not a girl in BC or in Newfoundland who feels that way either. And that's a big change. That's a big change from when I was a young thing, so young person. So times have changed a lot. I still feel that we want to influence our children in the best possible way, and we want to encourage them to grow up to fulfill themselves in every way that they can, both personally, in their careers, politically, in their friendships, to have the resilience, to have the self-control, to have the ability to make the most of themselves in the world. And it reminds me of a story, see I wrote here, Clinton's story, the story about Bill Clinton. I have no idea if this is true, but I'd like to think it is because it's such a wonderful story. He tells about a family that he met once who were from New York, and they had four children. And the parents were pretty dysfunctional. The parents were in and out of jail, and they had trouble with alcohol and drugs and so on. But of the four children, three of them ended up in some trouble themselves. They had problems in school, dropped out. One of them ended up in jail. They had issues with social services and so on. And the fourth child was tremendously successful and went on to live a very successful life. And of course, Mr. Clinton said, well, and that's the person he was talking to, how come? Like, why you? Why did you succeed where your siblings didn't? Like, what was the difference? And he said, I know exactly why I did. Every day on the way to school, I passed a little newsstand. And there was a person working in the newsstand, happened to be a woman, who said, how are you? What's going on today? You know, have a good day at school. And on the way home from school, said, how are you doing? How did it go? What, you know, do you have any tests? How'd you do on the tests? So when this young fella's own parents weren't really taking that role, this news person, over several years, now this is a person he never knew her last name, never was at her home, never had any relationship beyond this kind of passing them in the street and talking about how he was doing in school. But that one person's caring, beneficence, interest, encouragement, at a crucial time in the time of that young person, when he was building the kind of work habits. I remember the former judge of the Supreme Court, Bertha Wilson, who was asked in a speech, this is the risk of not reading, who was asked in a speech, to what do you attribute your success? How did you get to be a judge in the Supreme Court? And she said with her Scottish accent, good work habits. So this young newsy woman, this woman is selling magazines and gum and newspapers at the side of the road, encouraged this young fellow and was the sort of significant adult in their life. Now, usually it's a parent. Sometimes it's someone at a child care office. Sometimes it's a social service. Sometimes it's a person in your church or your temple or your synagogue. Sometimes it's an aunt or an uncle. It doesn't matter, as long as there is someone in that young person's life who really cares over a long time, over an extended period of time. So I take a lot of strength from that story and like to think that, especially for working women, I think on International Women's Day, it's such a great thought. And sometimes stories stay in your mind long after whatever else I said in speech fades away. My mother-in-law is a wonderful woman, and she recently was, a couple years back, was in a conversation with our youngest daughter. And Eleanor said, "Granny, you know, you said you had degrees in history, BA and an MA, but I've never seen your diplomas, I've never seen anything on the wall. Like, where are your degrees?" And Lois said, "Well, when I was back at university at Cambridge in the 1930s, women didn't get degrees. We were there at the pleasure of our professor. We were allowed to attend classes at their whim. And we wrote exams in a separate room, if you will, than the men. You wouldn't want to distract them." And this was truly the reasons. And they were given a sort of diploma, a kind of certificate to show that they had graduated, but not an actual degree. Well, Eleanor, being a modern young feminist woman, our daughter, said, "This is unacceptable." And she started into an email correspondence with the registrar of the college that her grandmother had attended at Cambridge, one Newnham College. Now, it turned out that Cambridge was actually had a pretty bad record. They extended their sort of degrees to women over 20 years later than Oxford did, through a vote of their board of governors and so on. Anyway, so they eventually did, and in 1948, before I was even born, they gave an honorary degree to the Queen Mother and proceeded to plan for a ceremony, which they had about a number of years later, in which 900 women were given the degrees that they had earned in the 20s and 30s and 40s, those who were still alive, in absentia. You know, they were given them all in one big ceremony. But my mother-in-law wasn't able to attend that ceremony, and Lois never got her degrees, as did many, many others. So Eleanor started this correspondence. Now, Cambridge has got traditions, like all universities, and they weren't going to just give it to her. They had to first investigate to make sure that she had really qualified, and they had to confer it at an actual convocation. The problem was the convocation was 2 days before a major birthday, and we really wanted to have this for the event. Anyways, long story short, and thanks to the history department here at University of Toronto, she was conferred the degrees at this convocation. They were FedExed over, which was complicated. They arrived on Friday. Eleanor had them framed, and we presented them to Lois on her 95th birthday. She's now 98, at a party that we had at our house. And the best line of the night, of the afternoon, was another granddaughter, not one of my kids, but her granddaughter, Kate, who said, "Oh, Granny, those degrees are going to look great on your resume." So we've come a long way. There's hope for all. Some of you might be the first in your families to graduate. Your children might be the first to graduate. It's about carrying the best of our values and our lessons and our pride in the past and giving it forward to those in the future. Before I open it to any questions or comments, I just thought I'd also mention one other issue. The theme for International Women's Day every year is different usually, and a little bit different, and this year the theme is "A Promise is a Promise, Time for Action to End Violence Against Women." And that's a good theme. It was also, though, unfortunately, the theme in 1999, 2007, and 2009. And I think the reason it keeps coming back is because we're not making enough progress in the area. So I'd like to hope that this year, this is the year that we do make some kind of progress on that. It's not right. I've been involved with a wonderful ballet company called the Atlantic Ballet Company, bringing a ballet around the country called Ghosts of Violence. It's beautiful, but it's also brutal, in which it demonstrates some violent scenes among couples. And we combine showing the ballet with discussions. We usually have the YWCA and some women's shelters and groups there, and hope that it stimulates even one or a few young or older women in the audience. We usually have school performances and public to to stand up and say this is unacceptable and to take the steps, scary though they are, to end that kind of relationship should they be in something. No one should be harmed or hurt, and we hope it encourages those to have the courage, and it takes courage to break away from violent relationships. I don't think I'm going to go into the whole business about women in politics. It's still mostly male-dominated. There's still a lot of room to be made. There are organizations that are helping. I hope your organization is breeding young and not-so-young women from different groups so that they will also feel that politics is an honorable and good profession and a place where they are not... as women feeling excluded. It's still a bit of a boys' club, and it'll only change if you invade, if you take it over, if you run in winnable seats, if you get the nominations. And goodness knows, I've always, you know, we do all this polling in this country. Who would you vote for? What do you think about this product? We've never done a poll that I know of 2 or 3 weeks before Election Day and go to all the different campaign offices across the country, and I guarantee you'd find out that most of them are staffed, womaned, if you will, by organizers who are answering the phones and making the sandwiches and, you know, making the calls. And there's lots of men who are involved almost always as the candidate or the campaign manager. But, you know, it's just one little small step to take it to the next step, to take the organizational and to turn it into actual participation. And that's why the one area in which I may be at odds with some people in the women's movement is I don't really believe in designated nominations. I don't believe that a party leader should just appoint someone as a candidate. I think part of the real test is to win a nomination, and the trick is to use that, the skill that we have in organizing, to bring in friends and family and organizations of like-minded people who believe in whatever it is you're running for, like the issues that Yasmin ran for, and get them involved and to win those nominations and then go on. But others have views that are different and feel that the only way is to have some designated appointments. I think I'm going to leave it there for now. I'm sure there are things I've forgotten to talk about, but maybe some of you will have them to say. Read the history, learn the history, learn about the people who fought for the progressive issues and the progressive causes. Be part of political life. And oh yes, there's one other thing that I will end with. It's another story, and I included it because of the group that you are. There's a photo. It's from 1913. It was described by Adrian Clarkson in a speech that she gave when she was Governor General. And she's with a group of people. I think they were Norwegian immigrants, mostly women in the picture. And they were looking, they're in a class to sort of become Canadian citizens. And there's a board behind them. And written on the board is the title, Duties of the Citizen. And it sure does an awful lot sound like the theme and motto of this organization. These were the things that were written on the list. Understand your government. 2, take an active part in politics. 3, assist in all good causes. 4, lessen intemperance. And 5, work for others. So it's not perfect and it doesn't include everything, but it's a pretty good list. Thank you very much. Thank you.